Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that is the most accurate translation into the English language. Let's begin today with Psalm 77. I cry aloud to God that he may hear me. In the day of my trouble I seek the Lord. In the night my hand is stretched out without wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted. I think of God and I moan. I meditate and my spirit faints. You keep my eyelids from closing, and I am so troubled that I cannot speak. Consider the days of old and remember the years of long ago. I commune with my heart in the night. I meditate and search my spirit. Will the Lord spurn forever and never again be favorable? Has his steadfast love ceased forever? Are his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up his compassion? And I say, it is my grief that the right hand of the Most High has changed. I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on all your work and muse on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have displayed your might among the peoples. With your strong arm you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. When the waters saw you, O Lord, when the waters saw you, they were afraid. The very deep trembled. The clouds poured out water. The skies thundered. Your arrows flashed on every side. The crash of your thunder was in the whirlwind. Your lightnings lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your way was through the sea, your path through the mighty waters, yet your footprints were unseen. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Those are God's words from Psalm 77. Our musical guest today is the Don Marsh Orchestra and Singers.
Oh,
that has been the Don Marsh Orchestra and Singers. Stay tuned for them again at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to Mark's Gospel, chapter 12, verses 1 through 12. Then Jesus began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a pit for the wine press, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the season came, he sent a slave to the tenants to collect from them his share of the produce of the vineyard. But they seized him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And again, he sent another slave to them. This one they beat over the head and insulted. Then he sent another, and that one they killed. And so it was with many others. Some they beat, and others they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But those tenants said to one another, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. When they realized that he had told this parable against them, they wanted to arrest Jesus, but they feared the crowd, so they left him and went away. Those are God's words from Mark chapter 12, verses 1 through 12. The story is told that two caterpillars were crawling along and noticed a beautiful butterfly soaring overhead. The first caterpillar said to his companion, "You could not get me up in one of those hang gliders for $1 million." Have you ever noticed that change is the only constant thing in life? One only needs to look at our city to see the changes. Oftentimes I will drive past a part of the city that I do not frequent and see a new building or a new church, and I am amazed. Change is happening everywhere. And this is so true of life. Yes, change is the only constant thing in life. And change can be really rather good. It is an opportunity to grow and mature. As we know from butterflies and caterpillars, one needs to grow and become as beautiful and mature as possible. Growth is part of God's design. And as such, we need to embrace positive growth and mature, following God's straight and narrow path. But this means we must give up the old and step forward in faith with the new. We must stop being caterpillars and soar as butterflies. And one huge, enormous change took place almost 2,000 years ago. For that was when God had had enough of the old Hebrew way and forever replaced it with the new Christian way, the final revelation of God's will for his people. And this is vividly described in our parable we will examine today. In our passage today, we see another of the parables given by Jesus Christ, our Master and Messiah. In the parables, Jesus tells us about real life. Now here we know that Jesus is speaking in symbolic form. Jesus is using similes to describe reality. In his parables, Jesus used metaphor, simile, and symbolism. And we know this was done because sometimes Jesus himself gave us the interpretation of his wonderful parables. The Greek word that we translate into the English word parable means to make a comparison or to set things side by side to be evaluated. Jesus did not always give us an interpretation to each of his parables, but he did so a number of times. Jesus did this so that we can learn how to unlock the divine truth that is sealed away in the wonderful parables of Jesus. Now remember, this is a parable. Parables are a specific style of storytelling where Jesus is teaching to make the listeners understand. Parables usually have a number of main characters, 1, 2, or 3. To gain an accurate understanding of the parables, we must acknowledge that Jesus intends us to learn a lesson from each main character. In our passage today, we have a rather complex parable, so let's look at it. There are 2 main characters, the landowner and the wicked tenants. The landowner is complex because he also has others working with him. They are part of his character and part of his role in the parable. So in a way, they are just his agents. But in another manner of speaking, they are really important. These agents of the landowner are described as his slaves, and finally, his beloved son. So recognizing the symbolism is important. The landowner represents God. The landowner's slaves are symbolic of the Old Testament prophets, ending with John the Baptist. And of course, the son of the landowner is symbolic of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the Son of God. Additionally, in the parable, in verse 9, we see a hinting at others who will receive the land. These others are symbolic of Christians, while the wicked tenants are the Hebrews of old. For Christianity did grow out of the old Hebrew way. Christianity has replaced that Hebrew way, and we as Christians must understand this and strive to mature in faith. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verses 12 through 13, we read, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic elements of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is unskilled in the word of righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, for those whose faculties have been trained by practice to distinguish good from evil." Now, the symbolism in our parable makes the unpacking of this teaching somewhat clumsy. So let's dig right into it. In verse 1 we read, "A man planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a pit for the winepress, and built a watchtower." Now this is symbolic of how God created all things. God is that person who made everything. In Revelation 4 verse 11 we read, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." And the metaphor of God being a landowner of a vineyard would have been immediately recognized by the Hebrews of that old time period. For an educated Hebrew would have known and well remembered Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. There we read, "Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved has a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed. Righteousness, but heard a cry." Do you hear how God is described? Yes, God is the ultimate landowner. Now, in our parable, it says that this landowner made all this stuff, then he leased it to the tenants. This means that God gave the land to the Hebrews, but he expected them to honor the covenant that God had made. We see this in the dealings God had with Abraham, the father of the Hebrews. In Genesis 17, verse 9, we read, "God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you throughout their generations." But the Hebrews did not keep God's covenant. As we see in our parable, the landowner sent his servants to collect what was due. Now, the background to this story is the ancient style of farming known as tenant farmers. The landowner would agree to let the renters farm the land, but the renters would be required to pay the owner a certain percentage of the crops produced. And when the landowner in our parable sent his agent to collect that rent, the tenants seized him, beat him, and sent him away empty-handed. The landowner tried again to collect what was rightfully his. So again, he sent another agent to them to collect the rent. This one they beat over the head and insulted. Then the owner sent another, and that one they murdered. And so it was with many others. Some they beat and others they killed. Do you see how wicked these tenants were? They were horrible squatters on the land. They were violent and evil. They continually harassed the rightful owner's agents to the point of multiple murder. And this is exactly what the Hebrew nation of old did when God sent them the prophets. There were many Old Testament prophets, but let's look to just a few of them as an example to see what happened. The Hebrew prophets were true people sent from God. They declared a message of peace and justice. They demanded that the poor and oppressed be treated fairly. They opposed the violence and the evil of ancient Israel. But did anyone really listen? Isaiah was one of God's slaves sent to show the people the right way. In Isaiah 2 verse 4 we read, God shall judge between the nations and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and neither shall they learn war anymore. When Isaiah brought that message, over 700 years before Jesus Christ, did the Hebrew nation listen? Did those renters pay attention to God's servant? No, for the Hebrews continued to be bloodthirsty and violent people. They turned their backs on God's way of peace and shalom, and instead, they were warring with their neighbors and within their own households. Isaiah could not have been more obvious than what he did. In Isaiah chapter 20, we read about how Isaiah was so concerned about the military alliances that were developing that God commanded him to even walk barefoot and to go naked for 3 years. Quite a sight. Isaiah was trying to convince the Hebrews to do what was right, yet they still lived in their violence and evil. And God even inspired another prophet to bring nearly the exact same message. In Micah 4, 3-4, we read, God shall judge between many peoples, and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. Yes, God sent messengers to the Hebrews, and yet these renters of the land abused both Isaiah and Micah, just as Jesus said in his parable. These are only some brief examples. God sent a multitude of prophets to God's people, but most were ignored and abused or even murdered. And the last of the Old Testament-style prophets was John the Baptist. And King Herod, even though he liked to listen to John, murdered him through state-sanctioned capital punishment. Yes, the wicked tenants murdered John the Baptist. But even in ancient times, God knew that the Hebrews would be replaced. In Jeremiah 31, 31-34, we read, "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sins no more." And this came about because Jesus Christ, the beloved Son, the heir of all things, came. Yes, God sent his Son Jesus, and yet it was he who was murdered by those evil renters. In our parable, Jesus describes his own murder. He says, "The landowner had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, They will respect my son. But those tenants said to one another, Ha, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and that inheritance will be ours. So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard." Yes, the renters thought that if they killed the son, they would be the owners. But that is an ancient lie. Way back in the Garden of Eden, the serpent told Eve, "Just eat the fruit and you can be like God." So the renters saw an alleged opportunity to get to be the owners and to take over, but that cannot happen. For no matter what we human beings do, we can never be God. In Acts chapter 2, 22 through 24, we read, "You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power." So the owners hear about the son's murder, and judgment is passed. The land is taken away from those wicked tenants. And historically, we know that this happened. Almost 2,000 years ago, God passed judgment on the nation of Israel. For just about 40 years after Jesus spoke this parable, the Hebrews tried to play God. They started a revolution. And God gave them over to judgment, and they lost everything. The city of Jerusalem was sacked, and tens of thousands were killed, and the temple was torn apart brick by brick. The year was 70 AD. That was when in the physical world, the Hebrew way was forever smashed and discarded. The Hebrew way was replaced by the Christian way. For now, the Christians are the renters of God's wonderful vineyard. Spiritually, this occurred at the cross, when Jesus died to pay the price for our sins. This was when the temple curtain was torn apart and Jesus rose from the dead. Yes, the Hebrew way is no longer valid. As Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." But that does not mean that people are without hope, for the change from the Hebrew way to the Christian way offers each and every one of us hope, eternal hope. As Romans 1:16 through 17 reads, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed through faith for faith, as it is written, the one who is righteous will live by faith." So yes, the Hebrew way has been replaced, and now the covenant community is the Christian church. The great pastor John Wesley once told of a time when he encountered a robber. John Wesley was riding along, and the robber stopped him and demanded, "Your money or your life?" John Wesley gave the robber the few coins he carried. The robber proceeded then to rummage through Wesley's bags and such, but he found only books, and the robber was very upset. He started to stomp away, but John Wesley said to him, "Wait, I have something more to give you." The robber turned, and Wesley said to him, "My friend, you may live to regret this sort of life you have chosen. If you ever do, I encourage you to remember this. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin." The robber then ran away. John Wesley continued onward and prayed for that man's soul. Years and years and years passed, and then one day, after a Sunday service, when many people were gathering to speak to John Wesley, one man, who was a prominent tradesman, lingered a bit longer than all the others. As they shook hands, the man took John Wesley's hands up and kissed them. He then explained that he was once that robber. He had never stopped thinking about the way John Wesley had acted, and the words, "The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sins," had changed his heart and his entire life. He had given up on evil and turned his life around. Change had happened. He said to John Wesley, "To you, dear sir, I owe it all." To which Wesley humbly responded, "No, no, not to me, my friend, but to the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, which cleanses us from all sins." I'm John Thornton. Thanks for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and change your life and become more righteous and give up evil. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches. of various denominations. Or you can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. Thanks for all your cards and letters. I truly appreciate all that you write. And we have received over 2,300 requests for Bibles and other Christian material from our friends in Ghana, West Africa. We've sent a vast multitude of New Testaments and thousands of tracts over there. If you want to be part of that, write to me and I'll put you on our newsletter. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, the Bible says that love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or arrogant or boastful or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So love Jesus Christ our Lord with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind. And love your neighbors as yourselves. And remember, we are even commanded to love our enemies. We'll finish today with the Don Marsh Orchestra and Singers.
Saved a wretch.